Hello and welcome to Inside the Innovation, where today we're going to be exploring one of the most mystifying concepts in e-commerce today, headless commerce. And to help guide us through this, I'm delighted to be joined by Igor Faletski, who is the VP of Product Management and manages all of our headless software. Igor, welcome.
Thank you, John. Great to be here.
Awesome. Let's get right to it. So what is headless commerce?
Great question, John. So headless typically means that brands are going API first, using APIs to achieve one of three objectives. The first one that's most common is building amazing digital experiences that are highly differentiated from brand to brand. And to get that custom look and feel, you're going to go API first to achieve that level of quality. The second reason is to get more operational agility. So for brands to be able to update their website or app 10 times more often than before, and building specialized DevOps processes to really make that something that's in their DNA and move much faster as a business as a result. And the third reason to go API first or headless is to build best of breed architecture. So we can combine commerce functionality from one vendor, search from somebody else, CMS from a third party into something that's a really highly customized architecture that is serving the unique needs of the brand and the shoppers that they have. So experiences, agility, and best of breed are typically three reasons to go API first and to explore headless for brands right now.
It's an interesting answer, because I think that a lot of people, when they think about headless, they think about this is just the front end technology, right? Like, I'm ripping the head off my application and it's going to be all these great web pages. But you're describing something that's not only front end, but really like APIs and a lot of back end stuff as well. So if it's not only front end, what's it really for?
Yeah. So I think the word headless is used so much because the idea of decoupling front-end and back-end is always present in this architecture, right? You always want to have the separation to can evolve the front-end and the back-end faster and more independently. But ultimately, like you said, John, it's also about kind of freeing up the data and being able to connect applications with one another and really having this composable and connected architecture that can have the full power of all the data the brand has and different applications that can be mixed and matched to meet their business goals. So the decoupled experience is a kind of a key requirement here, but the full story is this digital transformation and connecting all the different dots that exist in the shopper journey and between different silos within a brand organization.
Fabulous. So bearing that in mind, like, what is an ideal case for headless commerce? Because I think a lot of people enter into this and are like, I need headless commerce. That's the thing. But it may not be the right choice in every situation. Like, what are the best choices, or what are the best implementations for headless commerce, the best use cases that matter?
Yeah, so one thing I always recommend to brands that are looking at headless is figuring out, you know, what is their why for looking at API first. So we talked about these three initial reasons. Is it a great experience that you want to launch? Is this getting more agility? Is this bringing a new vendor with new innovation in that you want to have as part of your digital shopper's journey? And that why, I think, is really important to, first of all, understand for the business and then align with IT and partners on. And then once you see that headless is the right way, so you have to go API first, then you can really map out the right architecture and make sure that you have the right project plan to achieve that. If the brand does not have those requirements, if they don't have the maturity, that may mean that headless is something that should plan for slightly down the road, but not immediately as well. It's not for everybody just yet, because it does require, you know, a bit more resources and a more senior team that is going to start building those APIs.
No, and that makes a lot of sense to me. I think that, you know, I did a lot of implementations in my past, and it's super important to know where you're driving the car before you pick at the car that you want to drive there, right? Because, you know, roads are different. You want to pick the best choice. Awesome. So I know that you join us for Mobify, a recent acquisition. What does Mobify bring to Salesforce's headless story?
Great question, John. So, you know, we've been speaking to customers that are looking at headless or have gone headless, and over 40% of the cost is actually in the front end, so building the head. And wouldn't it be great if you could have a faster path to market launching your front end experience, and then an easier way to maintain it without having to deal with all this complexity of, you know, keeping up your front end infrastructure, CDN, security, all these kind of things. So Mobify developed technology for accelerating building out progressive web apps, and also a way to host them and to achieve high level of traffic and performance with our managed runtime. So we drastically reduced the complexity of launching a headless front end and make it very easy for brands to maintain that over time. So you can focus on custom features, custom experiences, and not this kind of middleware, this internal wiring that we at Salesforce can now do for them and manage for them and also pay for them when it comes to public cloud costs. So it's a great way to allow our customers to free up resources for innovation and not just reinventing the basics of the e-commerce platforms and e-commerce front ends, because we'll take care of that.
That's outstanding. I know that, you know, one of the tricks about headless is that you do end up owning quite a bit of infrastructure, and that can be more of a surprise than I think a lot of people are waiting for. So, you know, being able to host the runtime, having the, you know, everything done for you, I think is great. So as you look into the future, you know, what does the future hold for headless commerce? What are you working on?
Gee, I wish I could share my entire roadmap with you, John. A couple of things I want to mention, though, is that we are looking at how to lower the barrier to entry to headless, right? So headless, as we mentioned, requires a more senior team. We're trying to make it as easy to roll out these progressive web apps and get started on different touch points as it is to launch a normal templated website today. So we're really trying to lower that barrier and unlock innovation on new touch points that our customers and their shoppers want to be at. So if I look out, you know, 2-3 years from now, I think headless is going to be the norm. It's going to be the default building API first, but it's going to be a lot easier and organic for brands to do that without sacrificing the business user tooling that they have, without really having to do like a big rip and replace, which sometimes is the case with headless. So making it the norm, making it easier, and unlocking amazing innovation for brands and for shoppers alike, that's roughly our plan.
That's outstanding. And it really, it's a great time to be headed in this direction as commerce starts to appear in all sorts of new contexts. And you know, those APIs really help that happen. Igor, thank you so much for joining us today. I really appreciate your thoughts. And thank you for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this episode of Inside the Innovation, and we'll see you soon.
Thanks for having me.